Autism now affects more American children than childhood cancer, diabetes, and AIDS combined. In the last decade, the numbers of children diagnosed on the autism spectrum have risen rapidly. The Centers for Disease Control now puts the rate at 1 in 110. Tonight, we look at what these rising numbers mean. This is the face of autism.
I'm Karen. I'm 9 years old.
But so is this. Would you tell me your name? Would you tell me your name? I think your name is Juliana, and I think you're 8. Is that right? Is that right, Julie? And so is this.
My name is Logan Henderson, and I'm 8 years old.
Each so different, yet it's all called autism.
20. Good job, Julie.
You can see the differences more dramatically when you visit their schools. Okay. They learn differently.
That's right.
Juliana Hernandez doesn't talk. Although her teacher says she's very smart, she's in a special needs class. And at 8, she's still learning to count the days of the month.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Good
morning. Logan Henderson attends second grade at another elementary school. He's in a mainstream class but needs an aide to manage any kind of change, although her support is almost invisible in class. But in the playground, as Logan plays alone, his social disability is more obvious.
It's okay.
Frustrating.
Like Logan, Perrin Rapp can talk, but he's profoundly different in other ways. Perrin attends what's called a communication handicap program for children who need to go at a slower pace, although he's learning at grade level in other areas.
Can I be quiet?
Do you need a break? Are you asking me for a break? Do you want to read the story quietly? Is that what you're asking me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 2 minutes and then you have to come back to your
Wait, I went to the drop.
Hi, feet. You like that, huh? Okay, rub your feet.
Sally Rogers is a professor of psychiatry and behavioral sciences at the Mind Institute in Sacramento. MIND stands for Medical Investigation for Neurodevelopment Disorders. It was established with state funds at the University of California, Davis in 1998. Sally spent some time playing with Juliana, Logan, and Perrin, who are among the thousands of children with autism who've been evaluated at the Mind Institute.
No, I'm not autism.
No. Do you want to talk about autism?
No.
Okay, no autism. I got that. Would you rather have some Play-Doh?
No.
Or some bubbles or anything?
Nothing.
No? Nothing. You don't want anything today. Okay, I know how that feels. They all have common threads. None of those three children interact with me as a typical 8-year-old would.
Would you like a snack?
None of them converse with me as a typical 8-year-old would. And none of them really use the materials and the situation in the room like a typical 8-year-old would. But each of them showed their symptoms in a very different profile. Do you know Shrek's girlfriend's name, Perrin?
Venera.
What is it?
Venera.
Venera?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy, I didn't know that. Each of them wanted a different relationship with me. You know, Logan didn't want any interaction with me. Perrin wanted a lot of interaction with me. And Julie wanted access to the materials and was happy to interact with me, but doesn't have a good way of starting or maintaining the interaction because she doesn't have language to use. But we use nonverbal communication.
Like?
Well, she followed my cues, my gestures. We figured out what each other wanted. You don't need language for that.
Okay, there you go.
Describe how differently you see each of those three children. Where do you put them on the spectrum?
Well, autism has affected Julia particularly severely in her language and communication skills. She showed that she had some awareness of print, you know, when I was writing her name and she was copying it. I said some letters and she could write them. So it's clear that she knows more than she can share through words.
Oh, you
Perrin certainly has lots of skills. He can write, he could write names, he could figure out how to spell my name, he creates symbolic materials, he can carry on a conversation. But it's kind of a one-sided conversation, you know.
And Logan.
And Logan. Logan was so uncomfortable in the whole situation. And fortunately, Logan has language and knows how to use language to express his feelings. He didn't have to have a tantrum or be destructive or aggressive. He could communicate with his speech, which is a great gift to be able to share your feelings.
All I would like is alone time, and I would like to get out of here.
You'd like some alone time? Okay, you got it.
Logan has two older brothers, Jason, 10, and Matthew, 12. And remarkably, they both have autism too. In fact, although they share the same genetic inheritance, in their diversity, the three Henderson brothers almost represent the breadth of the autism spectrum. Each boy's symptoms are quite different, as their dad, Rick Henderson, describes.
You know, Matthew, for an example, my 12-year-old is extremely shy, very passive in terms of meeting people and being in different environments.
Matthew is high functioning on the
spectrum. Is high functioning on the spectrum. He is our highest functioning child and does very well. You know, he is mainstreamed in school and
good verbal skills.
Very good verbal skills. My 10-year-old Jason, who is what they would call moderate to severe in the spectrum, very limited verbal communication, but at the same time, very social.
What is your name?
His name's Jason.
Hi, my name's Jason.
What's your name?
Jason. We have the same name.
His name's Jason. He's Jason and you're Jason.
What's your name?
I'm Robert.
Jason especially has been a real challenge where his mind will wake up at 3 in the morning and he thinks it's the middle of the day and he's up playing and doing his laughing and giggling and turning on TVs and, you know, just really thinking that's the middle of the day. And you can't shut that off. And so we're up all night with him, ensuring to keep him safe and trying to prevent him from waking up the other two. And that happens at least once a week.
Ready? Set, go!
And then my youngest son, Logan, he's what we call our politely defiant one. He is considered high functioning, but not quite as high as where Matthew is.
Oh, no!
How can the Henderson brothers and the other children all be so different, yet diagnosed with the same condition?
Green light! Yellow light!
The answer to that question is where scientists disagree about what the rising numbers of autism diagnosis mean. Anthropologist Richard Grinker, a professor at George Washington University, says it's because we have widened the definition of autism.
It's where somebody who previously had the identical symptoms now is conceptualized differently. And so if you went back 30, 40 years, and you looked at people who were diagnosed with mental retardation, or who were diagnosed with what was then called childhood schizophrenia, you would find that, you know, those people 30 years ago would qualify for the diagnosis of autism today. And I suspect that we may see the prevalence of autism continue to increase, not because there are more cases. They were there all along, perhaps, but because we're getting better at locating them, finding them, and delivering services to these children and adults who really need help.
But a majority of the researchers we talked to believe that wider diagnosis explains only part of the increase in autism numbers. The rest remains the object of much scientific speculation.
Close to 1% prevalence that we know.
Among others, Dr. Irva Hertz-Picciotto, who heads the Division of Environmental and Occupational Health at UC Davis, sees many possible environmental factors.
There is a group that did look at the diagnostic substitution explanation, and they thought that maybe explained a quarter to a third. But in addition to that, there has probably been an environmental contribution for a long time. We, in fact, know that some of the potential environmental causes do include, for example, infectious agents.
Do you have candidate factors for those factors that may be fresh in the environment?
I have a lot of candidate factors, actually, and they include nutritional factors, infectious agents, chemicals in our environment, including chemicals in the household products that we use every day. There are a variety of factors that could be influencing development, and they may play a role at different points in development. But I think multiple factors contribute not just across the population, but within any one individual. So when I say that I think autism is multifactorial in its causation, I think that applies to even at the individual level, so that it might take two or three susceptibility genes combined with two or three environmental factors at critical junctures.
Which might explain why individuals with autism are so different, even though they share some obvious symptoms.
Exactly.
And I say, okay, there's this big prevalence increase in autism. That's undeniable. There's a prevalence increase. Whether it means that there's an increase in the real number of people with autism or not, there's a prevalence increase. But I see it as progress. I really see it as an achievement to be able to identify these kids who previously were either misdiagnosed or maybe had no diagnosis at all.
Sally Rogers has firsthand experience of the rising numbers as she works to identify and treat children with autism at the earliest possible age.
In my experience, the number of children who have autism has increased enormously. I remember 30 years ago when I started working with young children with autism in a real focused way, and I remember when I saw the first child in 1982, a two-year-old with autism, and 2 years later I saw another, and 3 years later I saw another. And now in the last 2 years, we've recruited 50, 70 two-year-olds with autism just here in this city. It's a phenomenal change from a clinician's experience in the prevalence of autism.
Whatever's happening to the numbers, there's a saying among those who know autism well: when you've seen one child with autism, you've seen one child with autism.
She's gonna blow!